The choice is yours, my uncle said. And my uncle was walking my cousin Debuda through the paddy fields of Bakura. Anyone been to Bakura here? Yeah. In the month of May? Noon? No. Okay. So my uncle was, my Jethu, he was walking my cousin Debuda through the paddy fields, taking him to school. And he was walking under the hot sun and profusely sweating. Debuda didn't like it, of course, but my uncle being a very humble man, and of course he was well placed. He was a district magistrate in Bakura, but he believed that, you know, people have to earn things, and that's where he was walking himself and his son through the paddy fields. And while they were walking through the fields, Debuda saw a very strange scene. There were two men and one umbrella. So this is a story of two men and an umbrella. So one man was very well dressed, and there was another man who was not so well dressed. And to his surprise, Debuda saw that the man who was well-dressed was walking very confidently, and the man who was not well-dressed was holding an umbrella, and not over his own head, but on the head of the other man, who seemed to be very well-dressed. And that's where he thought. He retrospected, he reflected, but he couldn't understand why on earth this could happen. Why is he not protecting himself, but protecting the other man from that hot, scorching sun? And the person who was holding the umbrella was sweating profusely. And with one hand, he was wiping his sweat, and the other hand, he was holding the umbrella. And this is where my uncle said, see, the choice is yours. The man who is under the umbrella is an educated man. He owns all these paddy fields, right? So he can employ a person like that. He seems to be not well educated, and the only occupation that he got was that of a servant, and was holding the umbrella in front of, on top of the other person's head. And the choice is, of course, yours. You want to be the man under the umbrella, or you want to be the man who is holding the umbrella? And that became the purpose story of my cousin Debuda. And he was a West Bengal topper in HSC. He scored very high in joint entrance, and he went to Bakura Medical College, and because he was staying in Bakura. And today, he holds the umbrella for himself, not for anyone else. And this is a story that my grandma told me maybe 30 years ago. I remember it very well because of the moral behind it, the purpose behind it. And that is the purpose story of my life. What is the purpose? Does anyone know what is purpose? Purpose is something. Yeah, you were about to say something, sorry. Yeah. So purpose is something which drives the passion. And without passion, there is no success. So anything and everything that I do in life has to be driven by a purpose. Let us pause for a moment and think about our projects, about our digital transformation projects. Do you know the purpose of the project that you're executing? Do you know? Okay. So what is it? What is the purpose of the project that you're executing right now?
The purpose is to integrate something with the bigger one. That is the correct purpose of that particular project.
Okay. Anyone else? Be the purpose of the project, be the purpose of any task that you are doing. What is there in it for you? What is there in it for me?
So when I started venturing out in Agile, someone said, why don't you go out of your box? And I said, oh, my organization, will they be okay if I go out? They said, yeah, why not? So I started going to meetups and conferences, and after a certain point, everything started, you know, sounding same. Same talk, same sort of people, same faces. And so that's when my purpose was my hunger, how I can learn more, and I can't do it alone. So I needed a community with me, you know, group study. That helps so much. I'm not a topper who can, you know, study on their own. I'm a topper who will actually sit with everyone, discuss and understand and discover.
Yeah.
So my purpose for my community work is my learning. I can't actually know everything. So it's only when these awesome speakers, they come and I listen to them, then only I learn.
So that's where she is. She's so successful and she works so passionately because she has a purpose to it. And unfortunately, this is not true for our transformation projects. According to Leading Digital, the book, which is written by Andrew McAfee, Didier Bonnet is a senior vice president of Capgemini Consulting, and George Westerman, and they are professors from the digital business in MIT. They say that, you know, they did a global survey of 431 executives and across 391 companies. And it is found that 42 of the senior executives don't have a digital vision. And out of that, only 34% of them share the vision with their senior and the, you know, middle level managers. Forget this. Look at this. Even your senior managers like me don't know the vision of the projects. What will the team members be knowing? And if I don't have the purpose, right? And if I don't understand what is there in with for me in this project, how will I be passionate about that project? And how will I drive success for that project? Do you think it is possible? I don't understand. I'm just told to write a small code of, small module or a small code. I will just work on this. I don't care how it integrates with other modules. Just a small example. Remember this? Thakur Maa Chulli? This is grandma's bag of tales for people, those who are, you know, not from the Bong community. You remember this, right? And this Thakur Maa Chulli, every person in this room must have heard from their grandmas, right? And these stories follow a parable and they have a moral. We have learned all these moral values of friendship, love from Thakur Maa Chulli. I bet it. Do you agree? Yes. So another reason why digital transformation programs fail is because they don't see their leaders walking the talk. Okay. They say, well, the value of our transformation program is transparency. Okay. I want to be a very transparent company. For my customers, for my employees, and for my, you know, services, service providers and vendors. But I don't follow transparency. Is that right? Yeah. So if I don't see my leaders follow transparency, how will I be aligned to that? And that's the value story that we are talking about. I was leading a digital transformation program for a 100-year-old company, and it's one of the Fortune 10 companies. And their transparency was one of their values. And believe me or not, the CIO used to have YAM chats, we call, to understand the pulse of the transformation. Suppliers like us, vendors, they were also invited into that YAM chat. And that's how you walk the talk. And that's how, that is the story that was taken forward for other transformation programs as well. It's a small thing, but he's living the value. How a value story can guide your transformation programs. But why do we need stories? Why not anything else? Yeah, Anand knows. Yesterday he he said a lot of psychology. Yes, go ahead. Sure. So, impact is more, definitely. So when I was talking about the scorching heat and the sweat, I'm sure those who have been to Bakura at that point of time must be, you know, imagining themselves in that paddy fields, right? Okay. So now we're going to do a small exercise. Again, sorry, everyone is doing an activity, so I also put in something. So we're going to show you a slide of 8 unrelated words. Okay. And it would be only for 5 seconds. And after that, we have to write down how much we can recollect, how many we can recollect. Okay? So please don't take a screenshot or a snap and then, you know, kind of this thing. Let's be honest and see what we can recollect. Okay? All right. Now is the time to write it down. Okay, we are done. Stop. Okay, sorry. Next slide. So how many did we get? Anyone got more than five? Six. Okay. And you, sir? Six. Dipti? Four. Okay. So this is not unnatural. I've done this exercise on a virtual webinar. So the Agile Community of Practice that he was talking about, I usually practice the sessions there before going for a conference. And they got 5 to 7. And that's kind of normal. It is not easy to remember unrelated words this way. What if we tie them to a story? Hot sun, sweating profusely and stuff like that. You know, put in some emotions to it. Will I be able to remember them better? Yeah? So let us do this exercise. Again, a list of unrelated words. 8 of them. Okay? So I wanted to do this exercise. I told my 11-year-old daughter to make a story out of it. So you laugh when you see the story, but by using these words, right? All right, let's see the story. Once upon a time, there was a nun. Her hobby was to bake. So the highlighted words are those words which were there in the previous slide. And one day she was walking down to the letterbox to post a letter to her cousin. As she stepped out of the it started to rain. Rain is another word. And she started to think about taking shelter under a tree. But then she saw a castle. And this is a castle that she's been seeing for some time now from the church where she lived. She thought this was a good chance to visit the castle. As she approached the castle, she saw the lady of the castle sitting by the window, enjoying the rain while reading a book. The nun knocked the door and asked for shelter. The lady ushered the nun inside the castle and treated her with cake from her bakery, from the nearby bakery. And she said something called rain-themed cake, which I couldn't comprehend much, but that's what it is. Both the lady and the nuns sat there chit-chatting while enjoying the rain. And they became good friends and they lived happily ever after. But she made this. So, and actually she also depicted that in a visual thing, but I thought it was too juvenile to put it here. So now we'll do the same exercise again. Okay. So we're going to go back to the previous slide of again the same 8 unrelated words. And we're going to tie them into a story, 5 seconds again. And this time we'll see whether we can remember them better or not. All right, now how many did you get? You couldn't make a story out of it? You want me to go back again? Okay. But some guys have already written. Okay. Okay, now you're seeing and writing. That's not fair, huh? He's seeing and he's just noting them down. Okay. How many did you get now? 8 of them? All 8 of them? Yeah, good. Partly because it was a second iteration. We knew the words. But the point here is that if you can tie things to a story, you remember better. Just as Anand said the other day, right? When we are listening to any language or information, only few part of our brain are, you know, activated. But when I'm listening to a story, multiple parts of my brains get activated. I don't know all the other name of the other parts, but this is something called neural coupling. And also, when I'm putting in metaphors like, you know, profusely sweating, hot sun, you know, then other parts of my, some certain chemicals are generated in my brain. Okay, my motor, the cortex activities increases. For example, if I say, let us drive this project home, what happens? My motor cortex is, activated. If I say, the client was so excited that he thought that he has won a lottery, the word excited again ignite certain part of my brain. And how is the Josh? Yes. So, when even if the digital leaders have a vision, digital vision, it is not easy for all employees to remember that, right? If we tie them to a story, it is easier to remember it. It is easier to communicate to my peers. So I tell you the vision of my program in a form of a story. What happens is she goes back, because she remembers it well, she goes back and she talks to her peers. And that's how the vision gets transferred from one person to another, repeated again and again and again. So it gets ingrained into our brains, into our hearts, and we become passionate about the program. Yes, of course.
I mean, one more reason to it is that before books, there was no other way to transfer the knowledge. So what has been seen that people used to transfer knowledge, you know, 2,000 years back, before that when there was no book, 2,000 or 5,000 years back, was through the story. So it is in our DNA to learn more through stories.
Practicing storytelling since ancient times. Remember those cavemen? They used to draw stuff on the, you know, on the walls of the cave. That's how we actually communicated with each other. It is ingrained in human beings. So why not leverage the art of storytelling? Right? But what has it got to do with digital transformation? Right? What is digital transformation, by the way? No one is volunteering. Anyone wants to volunteer? What is digital transformation? Oh, okay, no one is volunteering. I'm sorry. Yeah, they are only the people.
See, today every business is a IT-enabled business, right? Software-enabled business. So now what happens to the businesses which are not core IT or software business but are, you know, enabled by that? They require a transformation in their way of working and processes such that they are digitally, such that they are IT or software-enabled. In general, for general public, the IT and software-related work is called digital work, you know, which can be seen on screens. And hence, you know, that's in layman's language is the digital transformation. For sure, you know, if you get into a lot of technicality, which I think is not the intention.
Yeah. We are not going into technicalities, of course.
So did I do the justice?
Of course you did. And just in very layman terms, it is solving a business problem with the right strategy and the right technology. Okay. But sometimes we get so overboard with the sleek technology, we forget that there is a business problem that we have to solve. The client might not need a blockchain implementation, but we will enforce on that because let us do a POC and see how it works. So that's not the way how we should go about it. And digital transformation, although it is in rage nowadays, but it is one of the top risks in all the CIO's mind, because 43% of them said resistance to change is one of the most, one of the impediments. And it is the highest, you know, highest impediment that prevents a digital transformation from being successful. Because the key in digital transformation is not the word digital, but the transformation. And that is, again, change management. And we heard from Ananda how we can engage employees for that change management. Okay, so what are the problems that we are trying to solve today? We are trying to solve three problems. So employee change resistance, because when we implement a new solution, everyone will resist that. It is a change. It is from changing from an old way of working to a new way of working. A lack of expertise. Employees don't know how to use that digital technology. Again, translates to workforce agility to learn new skills. And the last but not the least, it is surprising. I was doing a podcast on, you know, how why digital transformation programs fail, and the person who was interviewing me was surprised. Customer readiness? Doesn't the customer always want sleek technology, good experience and this? The point here is, are we solving the problem? If we are solving the problem, customer will be ready. So it's more about customer collaboration. And this all relates to principles of Agile. Everyone is an agilist, and I hope you guys agree with me. All right. So can business storytelling solve these problems? It will certainly. It's one of the, you know, tools that a leader can have in his or her toolkit to alleviate these problems after a certain extent. But I feel that it is not used as much as it should have been done in the business scenario. Yes? It's not even used at all. Okay, good. So we kind of tried to use some facts, some elements of storytelling, like providing a purpose story. Just as we said, my cousin had a purpose story, and that is a purpose story for me as well. And I passed on that story to my children as well, and I hope they will make them their purpose story of their life as well. What is there in it for me? So that anything that you do, you have to think, what is there in it for me? All right, tell me a fact, I will learn. Tell me a truth, I will believe. But tell me a story, I will remember forever. Right? Do you agree? Okay. Yeah, yeah. This I downloaded from the internet. Someone else wrote something, twisted it. Okay. So this is a digital transformation program that I was leading for a 100-year-old company. And they manufactured healthcare equipments, industrial equipments, like a CT scanner, MRI scan machines, etc. And they are the leaders in that manufacturing, sector. And they are confident. No one can overtake them. Yeah. But then everything, although they were, pardon? So for obvious reasons, I'm not supposed to name the customer. Okay. And what happens is that they are very strong in manufacturing, but they have multiple systems. And everyone is smart and, you know, expert in the way of working wherever they are, in which department they are, yeah? But there is a lot of lag of the data being shared across departments. There is silos. So the person who is supposed to, you know, look at which machine is at which site will get a feed after one day. Site means a hospital site I'm talking about. And then, these machines, it has to be maintained and serviced by trained professionals. And then, certified professionals, because this is like kind of, you know, government mandate. So what happens is that the training data is again in some system. So there's a lot of hodgepodge, and we'll have to wait for one day to get the right data. And then based on that, we will take an action, whether this needs a predictive maintenance or we need to replace this machine. And we cannot take a chance on that because it's a healthcare provider, right? And when the machines reaches the end of life, we kind of sell that off to a third-party vendor. This is the entire life cycle of that product, okay, of that system. Now, what is the purpose or story of an IT, you know, person who does data analytics? So when we were running a visioning exercise, we call it as a visioning exercise, where you pull in everyone and they talk about the problems and how do you, you know, kind of resolve the problem and solve the customer's business problem. So the IT guy says that what have I got to do with this mobile app you're going to launch? Anyways, I'm at the back end and I will just do some data analytics on my Excel. I don't care about what digital transformation you're doing. It is just a fad. Right? It'll come and go, and we'll be there where we are, and we'll do the same analytics. Well, that's where these are called anti-stories, where we kind of try to tackle the negative sentiments, and we bring in a purpose to them, and we tell them that, boss, yeah, you will keep doing the same activity as you're doing, but in a more efficient manner. Remember, the time you take to go and, you know, coordinate with the other departments to get the data, that will be resolved because you are getting a one view of the entire system. You know which site is there at which location, and you get the data on the tip of your fingers. So you still do the analytics, but your life is much easier, right? So that's a purpose story. Start with the why. Again, from Simon Sinek, everyone knows this. You have to start with the why. What is there in it for me? And that we call it as a purpose story. Listen more and tell less. Oh, wait a second. Isn't this all about storytelling? Then why are we talking about listening? Any idea? No Deepthi anymore. Huh? Someone else. Why are we talking about telling? Listening, sorry, not about telling.
Gautam Buddha said that if I'm telling, I'm just repeating myself. If I'm listening, I'm learning new thing.
maybe the story is about, story should be adapted to that particular person, so we should learn to understand what that person...
Understand what is he going through. Yeah. Any other... So you have to keep your mouth shut and talk more.
Yeah, I mean... Yeah, listen more. So biologically also it makes sense. As I said, I mean, we should listen more and speak less.
Yeah. Okay.
I can say we all have our inherent biases. And when we listen, we are able to get different perspectives, and those will help bust some of the biases.
So once upon a time, there was a salesman, okay, and he was a very smart salesman, and and he has graduated from IIM, okay, and he was given a steep target because he came from a premium institute, and he was smart, and he was told to sell something. Can you guess what? Televisions. Okay. So being a smart salesman, what he does is that he forgets the urban area because he knows everyone has a television here. So he goes to the rural area, to some village. I forgot the name of the village. And he says, let me study the market first and then I will give my sales pitch, just as all salesmen do. And what he did is that it was again a cold evening like yesterday. It was a cool evening. And he was standing outside the village and he saw from a distance, he saw there was a fire. Around the fire, there were some villagers who were having this wonderful cooler chai or the masala chai. And they were enjoying and they were chit-chatting with each other. And he stood there for 30 minutes and he saw the enthusiasm never drained. And this went on for 2 to 3 hours, and he thought, well, he couldn't make sense what was going on there. So he goes back to his home. Next day he goes back again, and he sees the same set of villagers around the fireside, and they were again chit-chatting. And this continues for 5 more days. And then one fine day he gathers some courage, and he goes and, you know, meets the villagers, and he asks, so what are you guys doing here? So one of the villagers was surprised and he said, oh, nothing, just stories. The salesman thought, wow, this is a great opportunity for me to pitch my sale of television, right, my sales pitch. So what he did is that he took out the television and he started demoing it. And he said, see, this is a wonderful invention of mankind. It gets you stories from all across the world. So you can, instead of just sitting here, you can be at the comfort of your home and listen to stories all the time. So the villagers were also excited because they loved stories. So what they did is each one of them bought one television. The salesman was very happy. He has achieved his target. He goes back home. He parties. And it was a good year end for him. Good appraisal as well. Then after a few months, he happens to walk down that village again. And this time he sees the same scene, fireside, villagers having cooler chai, their enthusiasm never drained, and they were chit-chatting. And he was worried. God knows what happened to the televisions. And he sees by the nearby, under a tree, all the televisions were stacked, and they were gathering dust. Now he was more worried. So he decides to go and confront the villagers and ask, guys, what are you doing? So they said, oh, nothing, stories. Then said, what happened to those televisions that I sold last year? Are they not working? Then the villagers said, oh, no, they are all working. It is a wonderful, device. It got us stories from near and far, from close and dear. But there was only one problem. It never listened to our stories. So that's how human beings are wired. We need to be listened as well. And the next two opportunities of storytelling in digital transformation is all about story listening. So the next one is about get frontline dispatches. It's too wide, right? So it says get frontline dispatches. These are the inside stories. Digital transformation is not about just deploying a solution. It is about adapting a solution. How your employees, how your customers, how your suppliers, vendors adapt a solution. But how will you know if you don't listen to them? So this is where what you do is that you sit and listen. Run something called anecdote circus. So there is a book called Stories at Work by Indranil Chakrabarty, and he explains how you can gather inside stories from your employees, from your customers. What you do, you send your employees to your customer location. We do that, and we, you know, observe them, how they are working, and we gather those inside stories. This is a case of story listening, listening to their pain points and happy points, and tell that story back to your team. The team listens and they devise their solution, and then kind of you solve the customer's business problem. That means you're collaborating with the customer, you're understanding their business problem, and that's one of the important usage of story listening. So what we did is that we listened to the stories and it was transferred to our team members so that we can really understand what is the pain point and solve them through our solution. The next one is again story listening. No more telling. Draw from the past. That is, gather the success stories. Small point. How will you know? How will you motivate your team to see that, you know, transformation is possible? You can gather stories from past transformation efforts just to prove, yeah, change is possible. It's not only possible, it has happened before. Then what you do is you kind of talk with your employees and understand what have they learned from the transformation efforts. And this is something that I learned in knowledge management, someone was saying, right? Storytelling for knowledge management. Someone said about, no? Okay. So this is something, it's an important technique that I learned from the PMI EMEA Congress in Berlin. And there people were talking about how to do knowledge management for the workforce of the future. If you tell to do documentation, if you force them, it will be just haphazard. So what can you do? You can do something called an expert interview. So I can tell Pratik, okay? I can ask him 3 questions. How was your life before the transformation? What did you experience during the transformation? And how is your life after transformation? And those can be recorded, just as you were recording the video. It could be an audio recording, and it could be circulated across as a podcast. And those are the success stories that I'm talking about. But what works in storytelling? It has to be inclusive. If I go to a global congress in PMI and I talk about paddy fields and sweating and all, it doesn't make sense to them. Maybe I'll have to talk about cornfields and cowboys and all. Maybe. I have to feel that it has to be relevant for them. I have to feel myself there, right? It has to be relevant for my society. So it has to be relevant. Otherwise, the stories don't make sense, right? All stories will not be a success story, but positivity in the story should be there. There would be sad stories, but what did we learn from them? Those things work in storytelling, even in business storytelling as well. But what really does not work? You'd say, I'm telling a story, but you give lots of facts, figures, margin, revenue. You're talking to a group of software engineers. It doesn't make sense to them. You have to talk in terms of that, how it is going to affect their lives. I can't say I'm going to expand into 5 continents and this, that. Okay, that's your target. That's not mine. Right? And this is the complexity kind of dilutes the purpose of the story. This turns listeners to kind of passive listeners. Because, yeah, you are a big boss. You're coming and saying, but I'm not listening. Right? And if I'm a passive listener, I've not got the gist of the story. I will not share it with anyone. The sharing also gets affected. But how can you turn passive listeners to, you know, active listeners? Of course, you have to make it more relevant to them, make it more, make them feel inclusive, that it is for them. You can have some gamification techniques, right? You can have online quizzes while you are, you know, narrating stories. And that can help you to turn those passive listeners to active listeners. And once they understand the story, they will share it with their peers. And it will be repeated again and again. But what are the modes of storytelling? It could be something like face-to-face. I narrated a few stories here. It could be in the form of town halls, where you make eye contact and you get... I see people nodding means, you know, they are actively listening, right? So I get a pulse of how the transformation is going. It could be over a video call. Puneet said, face-to-face is the best mode of communication, and storytelling is a mode of communication, of course. video call helps me to understand the listener's, you know, body language, helps me to translate the story in a different way so that it is relevant to them. So video conferencing, people are very happy. I think they reach some milestone there. And visual. This is something which I think has a great effect on mankind as well. Anything that is told in a town hall and a video conference is graphic recorded this way in the form of, this is I've downloaded from the internet, Simon Six. So, but yeah, I have a good friend who is a visual graphic recorder. So anywhere we in Capgemini, wherever we have big workshops and all, the entire workshop journey is recorded this way. And that is hung in the hallway or on the virtual project board. So the people are reminded of the story again and again and again. And last but not the least, social media. I'm a big social media fan. Use WhatsApp, use Snapchat, I don't use. But you can use YamChat, Skype, YouTube for video, you know, messages, etc. And leverage it to the full extent. People might say that what things become public, have closed groups. Just as we have a WhatsApp group for this conference, you can have a closed group. You can pass on messages. It's a constant reminder of the people, of the purpose story, the value story, the success story, as well as the insight stories. So that's a recap. Start with the why, and that's the purpose story. Get frontline dispatches. That's the insight story, how the transformation is going and, you know, well, the insights of the customers' pain points, etc. And draw on the past. That is a success story. And all this is guided by nothing but the value story. So in this case, it was transparency. Okay? And these are the references. Leading Digital, Stories Does Stick. Stories at Work is a very nice book that I've read. And The Story of Purpose. And that's me. So in case you want to connect with me, those are my email ID. I am very active on social media and LinkedIn as well as Twitter. When I also have a small blog where I talk about the future of project managers' work, because I'm a project manager, of course. So how the future of project managers' work will change, right, with automation, AI, and all that stuff. It is not about learning new skills all the time. It is about how you engage your employees, engage your team members, and storytelling is one of them. So if you follow hashtag future of PM work, you can find, you know, the blogs that I've written. And I also lead the Agile Community of Practice, as he said in the introduction. And that's where that community has given me a lot of strength and a lot of insights into the agile world. Whatever I've learned, even the speaking, everything I practice there first before I come and speak. So that's a platform for me which has given me total credibility, even in the large organization of 100,000 employees like Capgemini. So do build the community. Do tell stories, because stories do stick. Let's put the stories to work. Any questions?
Thank you, ma'am. Your speech was highly stimulating. When you are telling a story, if you get a hostile audience or an audience which is not paying attention to your yawning and giving staring reaction, then how do you handle that situation? Just any tip or thing that you'd like to say?
It's not about only in case of stories, even in conferences. You'll see some people who are yawning. So usually, this is my trick. I will ask some questions to them. Okay. I will, try to engage them by asking some questions. What do you think, sir? What is your experience? So that's how you get them engaged. That's one. Second, I also talked about gamification. Puneet used it very well by giving those books, you know, asking questions, encouraging people to talk. You're transforming your passive listeners to active listeners that way. And they're getting engaged and they're talking, right? So that is another thing. Also, you can do one thing. Before you go for a session, you talk to people who are coming to the session. Okay. So, for example, yesterday I was here. I spoke to many of you all. Try to understand the pulse of the, you know, audience. And, you know, try to gather those stories which we call as anti-stories. Okay. So, what of your purpose story, you know, kind of mellows down that anti-story? You know this person in the IT department is against digital transformation. When you tell the story, you kind of talk about that and see how his life will be. That's how you manage that anti-stories.
Thank you, madam. Excellent speech, no doubt. Just to share my thought, because even I am this public speaking, and I recently met, you know, some critic from New York Times. I was in the U.S. last month. And there's few learnings. I mean, they have been, you know, shooting the video of few people, and they were screening, and they were giving the feedbacks. So just to let the audience know, first of all, your story must have a hero or heroine, and it is not you. It is somebody else. Basically, that person is talking through you. It's blooming through you. So that is one part. And the next thing is that whenever the speaker comes to the stage, as I think I was talking about there, I mean, personally, I don't feel to be in the stage, in the podium. So I always stand below and, you know, so make them feel that, you know, we are all together. So it's a 3D movie. I mean, you know, you're not outside, you're inside. Everybody's inside and everybody is connected. And small sentences, you know, glorious things, and make people connected, as you rightly said, that bring them into the, to your speech and ask them questions and stuff like that, and touching words.
Thank you very much. This is, again, an inside story that you heard. Yeah, I also hate standing on the stage. That makes me very nervous. And when I'm standing here, I feel I am one of you and I'm connected with you. And that's why I always, you know, in some cases you can't because there are big stages. You have to stand on them. But in this case, I was fortunate. I could walk up to that audience and, you know, create that connect. All right. If there is no other question, then any questions? No. All right. So remember those three you know, words that we said about storytelling. Get your purpose story, get frontline dispatches, and draw on the past. That is the success story.